Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. This past weekend, the entertainment world lost a superstar. She's the only singer with 7 consecutive number one hits and has won more awards than any other female artist in history. Her friends and fans have said that Whitney Houston had one of the greatest singing voices of all time. Efren Graham has more.
From the moment she was introduced to the world, Whitney Houston was a star, selling more than 120 million albums worldwide, winning 6 Grammys and recording 11 number one singles. The singer's musical legacy transcended generations, and she got her start in this Newark, New Jersey church, singing in her mother's choir. At the news of her death, church members gathered to pray.
We feel that we should keep that family in prayer, and that is what we are doing here today. We lost a great person, and there's nothing we know that God is in charge of all things.
Emotionally just distraught, but God is still good.
Houston was found dead in her hotel bathtub Saturday afternoon. Authorities say there was no sign of foul play. The singer was in Los Angeles for the Grammys, and last night, when the music world came together, they opened in prayer, mourning her loss.
And to have her lasting legacy of music to cherish and share forever.
There is no way around this. We've had a death in our family.
I just want to say to Whitney up in heaven, we all love you, Whitney Houston.
Only a few nights before her death, Houston attended a Grammy party with her 18-year-old daughter, Bobby Christina. She took to the stage with Grammy nominee Kelly Price for an impromptu duet. That would be her final performance. Those close to the star say they'll remember the applause as Houston left the stage and took a final bow. Efren Graham, CBN News.
Well, joining us for more is Marlise Koss. She's the former tabloid journalist and author of Tabloid Prodigy. She's with us via Skype. Good to see you again. It's been a long time.
It has. Thanks for having me.
10 years ago, Whitney talked about her drug use to Diane Sawyer. She said, "The biggest devil is me. No one makes me do anything I don't want to do." Do you know what, if anything, anyone tried to do to help her?
Well, I think if you focus on what the Bible says, setting your hearts, your affections, your minds on the things above and not on the earthly things, I think the only person who could have really helped Whitney was herself and relying on God. And I think she started out as the good girl in the 80s and also in the early 90s. And then what happened in 1992, she met Bobby Brown and her life slowly started to spiral out of control. It's such a sad, sad, tragic ending. She had an angelic voice. She was such a beautiful woman. And I think part of her really longed to reconnect with God. And it's just sad the way it all ended.
You had an encounter with Bobby Brown involving Whitney. Tell us about that.
Well, while I was working for the tabloids, part of my job was to actually go out and find news involving Whitney and Bobby. And between the two of them, they both kept me pretty busy while I was at the tabloids. But there was one episode where I was out in Hollywood, and part of my job was to actually just look for news and see who was out and about and turn that into a story. And I ended up running into Bobby Brown in the VIP section of a nightclub in Hollywood. And we had heard rumors that their marriage was sort of falling apart. And as you know, they married in 92 and then they divorced in 2007. And during that time, they had a very rocky relationship. And so while I was at this club, we were looking to see how Bobby Brown was behaving and what he was doing. And ironically, he came up to me, started dancing with me, asked for my phone number. And next thing we knew, another journalist had taken a photograph and he saw the flash go off and he ended up calling in his bodyguards. They tore the club apart and he was raging. And so I think there was this short temper and this kind of behavior, and it was he was very erratic. We noticed a lot of this going on in their relationship.
What is it about stars that they seem to have this incredible fame, but the number that seemed to have been caught up and drugs is just is incredible. Is this a price to pay for fame?
Well, I think when you become famous and you are involved in that celebrity lifestyle, what you're doing is you're abandoning any opportunity to have a normal life. You have no privacy. You open your door and someone's taking a photograph of you. They're following you around. I think what happens is your life is anything but normal. And so I think there is a price to pay. But you look at celebrities such as Celine Dion, Tom Hanks, some of these other people, I think the best thing to do is stay as far away from the toxic lifestyle of Hollywood, to not get caught up in the parties and the drugs and the alcohol and all of the things that are often associated with being part of that industry.
Well, what role does the media play? There seems to be a love-hate relationship with media, with tabloids, that, you know, on one level, if as long as they spell your name right, that's good. But on another level, it seems like this sort of good girl, bad girl image feeds that and feeds a publicity machine. Does the media have a role to play here?
Well, I can only speak for myself when I was at the tabloids. And if someone had a film coming out, what we would do is we would actually say, okay, let's take celebrity X, Y, and Z, and let's find out what they are up to. And if it's good publicity, it's bad publicity, it was still publicity. And what you have with a lot of these celebrities, in the case even of Whitney Houston, her career was hot in the 80s and the 90s, and then she sort of had a slump there, and then she made a comeback in 2010, 2011. But you really have this yo-yoing of careers. And so I think part of that situation is it is triggered by the media, but they want to stay on top. And that feeling of, okay, what's happening to me? My identity has been associated with my fame. Now, who am I if I'm not on the cover of another magazine? And so there's this ongoing pressure to stay on top. And sometimes that involves behaving badly to get there.
What got you out of this? You were into it. You were sort of a tabloid prodigy and had quite a track record for getting the exclusive story. What got you out?
Well, I think there were a number of things that ended up getting me out of the industry, but one of the final stories involved Madonna, and I was handed a photograph of Madonna that, to me, the image had appeared to have been stretched, and it was her 40th birthday, and the editors had asked me to write a cover story called Madonna Fat and 40, and I looked at the image and I said, this has been stretched. She's doing yoga. She's never looked better. This is a lie. And I don't want to write this article. And everyone sort of started laughing and thinking, well, what have you been doing? And my point was, maybe I lied to get the story, but what I wrote was the truth. And so for the first time, they asked me to write a blatant lie. And I said, I can't do it. And so that was pretty much the final straw that made me walk away. But it was tearing me apart. I didn't know who I was anymore. Every day I was putting on another identity, pretending to be someone else. And in the process, I lost my own identity and sacrificed my faith, my friends, my morals, everything, just to break another headline.
Do you see a wake-up call here? We certainly have gotten a lot of them, you know, going back over the years. Is what's happened to Whitney, is that a wake-up call for Hollywood? Is it a wake-up call for America? And if so, are we going to answer it?
I sure would hope so. I think this, what's happened with Whitney, is it's impacted so many people more than I even imagine that it could. I think she was such an icon. And I think right now the public is waiting for answers. We want to know, okay, what really did happen? But if you look even at Michael Jackson and now Whitney, I mean, we have some of these incredibly talented musicians, and now they're not here. I hope that this has been a wake-up call. I imagine it has.
All right, Marlies. Thanks for being with us again. For more on her story, check out her book. It's called Tabloid Prodigy, and it's available wherever books are sold. We'll be back with more of 700 Club Interactive. We're going to take you all the way to Senegal right after this.
Hi. Hi, I'm Valerie Bertinelli, and today we've been asking what so many women would like to know, how Cindy Crawford seems to have defied the aging process. She's 43 years old, and she looks like she hasn't aged a day in years.
She's proud to say I am 43, and I look great. And we all want to know, what is Cindy Crawford's secret?
The secret to Cindy's ageless skin is French anti-aging specialist Dr. Jean-Louis Sabag.
Dr. Sabag is one of the most sought-after skin doctors on Earth, with models and VIP clients who flock to him for his exclusive treatments and formulas.
Now, in a remarkable advance, Dr. Sabag has infused the powerful melon extract at the heart of his treatments into an anti-aging system called Meaningful Beauty.
Ever since I first started using Cindy Crawford's Meaningful Beauty, my skin feels firmer, lines are less visible. Now, how would you like to see results like that for your skin?
And now you can, because Cindy has made it so easy. Normally $119, but order now and pay just $39.95. Plus, for a limited time, your shipping is free.
My skin is much tighter. There's obviously something in this incredible melon that makes our skin look younger.
Watch as over time, an ordinary melon decays, while this melon stays amazingly youthful and preserved.
Each day using Meaningful Beauty, I feel younger and younger. Pores are going away, fine lines are disappearing even more to where I don't notice them at all.
Order in the next 4 minutes and receive bonus gifts worth $50. Plus, order now and your shipping is free.
Hey, I'm almost 50 years old. I don't expect to look like 20. But I'm feeling pretty darn good about how my skin looks and feels.
So call now and get the magic of Cindy Serums for your skin. Call 1-800-799-6939. That's 1-800-799-6939.
Grab your phone, make the call, and get the skin you've always wanted.
In Senegal, we met a girl who dreams of becoming a star. And Orphan's Promise is helping make that dream a reality, even though she was born deaf.
Miriama is 10 years old and has many dreams for the future. But only a year ago, she had no hope at all. Miriama was born deaf. Her mother couldn't take care of her and left Miriama with her grandmother.
Miriama always cried when other children went to school and she had to stay home. I paid a lot of money for her to attend a hearing school, but she didn't learn anything there.
It wasn't easy in the regular school. I just copied what others did, not understanding anything. That made me very sad.
Then her grandmother heard about a school for the deaf supported by Orphan's Promise. She enrolled her immediately. Here, Miriama learned how to read and write and how to sign. She has a lot of friends at the deaf school and even showed off some of her dance moves when we visited.
Miriama's only been at this school for a year, but she's excelling beautifully. In fact, this is the only school for the deaf in all of Senegal. Since she's come here, she's getting a great education, and she's learning communication skills that will really change her life forever.
Miriama's teacher says she can't believe how far she's come in such a short time.
Miriama is a very good girl. She loves to listen and learn all she can. And I know that she'll be very successful in life. Miriama is very happy in her new school. She's a good girl and studies hard.
Because of this school and the support of Orphan's Promise, Miriama can grow up with skills she never knew she had. And she can hold on to a great dream.
I want to enroll in a beauty pageant when I grow up and become Miss Senegal. I really love my school here. Thank you, Orphan's Promise, for all your help.
And thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of that. You're part of bringing help to people around the world. We're a lot more than a TV show. We want to reach out. We want to help people. And whether that's orphans in Senegal or drilling water wells for villages in India or helping with cleft palate surgeries in China, you can be a part of it. How? Just by joining with us, saying, yes, I want to be a member. How much is that? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day, and you reach out around the world. We do more than just broadcast in English in the United States. We broadcast in over 30 languages to over 130 countries around the world, and you can be a part of it when you join with us. So if that's you, give us a call, 888-777-1999. It's a toll-free number. Just say, yes, I want to be a part of it. I want to join the 700 Club. And if you want to give a special gift just for Orphans Promise to help orphans around the world, you can just say that when you call. Or you can log on to CBN.com, and there's a place on the giving page for a single gift. If you want to designate your giving to Orphans Promise, you can there. Call us, 888-777-1999, or say, I'll do it on the Internet. Log on to CBN.com. Well, up next, hear why one Latin music star walked away from a multi-million dollar record contract.
That was frightening, to be on my own with this little baby. I didn't know what I was going to do. It didn't take long before I started saying, okay, what about this Jesus thing? What does that mean? And I would cry out to him again, please tell me. If this is real, please tell me. I just can't believe it. I never would have thought that I would be here one day. I don't know that any of us deserve, you know, the life he has in store for us. But he has it to offer, and we just have to become willing to take it.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
700 Club Interactive. It's your show, and we want to hear from you. Now it's easier than ever. Join the 700 Club Interactive community on Facebook. Share your ideas, send prayer requests, and give us your input, because many of our show ideas come from you.
Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Today we're talking about dreams.
700 Club Interactive. Your show, your voice, now on Facebook.
700 Club Interactive is your show. And if you've got suggestions for the show, all you have to do is put it on our Facebook page. It's 700 Club Interactive. If you're already in Facebook, type that into the search and you'll come to us. If you've got questions for today's show, just put it into the chat room. If you've got questions on celebrity and what is going on with them in today's world, just put that into the chat room. We'll get to it later in the program. Well, here's a story that's unusual, someone who walked away from celebrity. When Lisa Lam was a young girl, she turned to music as a way of escaping her pain. But after she became a star, Lisa's music career was no longer a refuge from pain. It was the source of it.
Lisa Lam's rising star in the Latin music world garnered her a Grammy nod in 1998. But behind the glamour, a toxic relationship threatened to destroy her.
He would hit me, and I would hit him. It was like we were boxers boxing at each other, you know? But it was just a very intense, very love-hate relationship.
All through childhood, the love and attention Lisa craved from her father eluded her.
His first love was getting drunk, going to the bars and drinking. And so that caused a big emptiness in me as his daughter. And then when he would come home, there would be such chaos. He would throw chairs at my mom, throw the table at her, you know. I would just try to get on top of her and try to protect her.
But Lisa had no one to protect her the day her uncle lured her to a park and sexually abused her. When Lisa got home, she told her mom everything.
Really, really scarred me really deeply, you know, as a 12-year-old. And the hard part of all of it was, once we started talking about it with the family, my dad decided that he didn't believe me. You know, he thought I was making it up.
Lisa escaped those painful memories every time she performed on stage. first in school plays and pageants, then as the lead singer of a local Tejano music band.
And I thought, you know, this is going to be a way to win my dad over so he could see that, you know, I can sing just like him, and then also become this big star where I can take my whole family and just give him a whole different life.
Lisa pursued success at any cost.
The only way I was going to get my career started was if I was involved with someone that was already had a name and was already established. I was going to use anyone and in any way to get what I wanted.
She saw her chance when she opened for a popular Latin singer and record producer named Alex Montez.
My first impression of Lisa was like, wow, the voice, the look, I mean, she's got the whole package.
Alex produced her first demo. Soon after, Lisa landed a record deal and released her first album, Yo Quiero Soñar.
BMG pushed the album, and the album did really, really well. And we got gigs and tours, and we got on the road and then started doing the career. I mean, it happened so fast. You know, here you are wanting it so badly, you know, and then boom, it's right there, and everything starts happening so, so fast.
Meanwhile, Alex and Lisa's relationship went from professional to romantic to volatile.
He had multiple, you know, ladies in his life. He's a rock star, touring everywhere. And so I felt very threatened.
I was so messed up and with so many different things. There was already drugs going on, alcohol. I used to see my violence towards her when I hit her as like she provoked me, you know, to do it. But there was really something greater, darker working inside of me.
It ended because I made the decision to leave. I couldn't do it anymore.
Lisa refocused and went to work on her second album, Destino. She used cocaine to numb her pain over the breakup.
It was an escape for me, and it was easy to get. When I was at the clubs and I would, you know, be high, I would remember being in the bathroom stalls with my hands against the walls and just like, what am I doing? You know, how did I get here?
One day, a couple of old friends invited Lisa out to eat. It was Alex's brother and sister-in-law.
They were very interested in how I was doing. And then he started talking to me about the love of Jesus. He started speaking to me about the forgiveness that he has. And I said, I need that, you know? I was hurt as a child, hurt as a teenager and an adult, and I don't want to live like this anymore. And he grabs me by my hands and he starts praying with me and says, just repeat after me if you want Jesus to be your Lord and Savior. And I did, and it was amazing because at that moment I prayed and I instantly felt like just hit Jesus' arms embraced me and just completely received me. And everything was turned around after that.
Lisa was determined to leave her old life behind.
One day I was reading the Bible and there was a scripture that stuck out to me that, you know, I couldn't live a double life. And so I prayed and I asked God, help me.
Lisa met with the record label and decided to walk away from a $2.5 million record deal. Around the same time, she says Jesus healed her drug addiction and her broken heart.
I was really able to understand to forgive the men that had hurt me in my life.
Including Alex. When Lisa learned he had also become a Christian, they slowly built a friendship. Now, after 14 years of marriage, they pastor a church together in Angleton, Texas.
Now, just, you know, having the incredible joy of her being my wife with the blessing of the Lord and of her parents and my family. I mean, God is amazing. I feel complete.
And he's a great dad to his kids and a great husband. We were headed for disaster and the Lord stepped in. And only God can do those things, you know, and we're very, very grateful and very humble to the Lord.
The couple recently returned to the studio to record a new project, Renew Me, in English and in Spanish. Whenever Lisa gets the chance, she shares the love and healing she's found in Christ through music.
Freedom completely comes, you know, when you say the name of Jesus, you know, and receive him, freedom in every area. So he is my lifeline. He is my protector. He is the father that I've always wanted.
And he'll be that for you. He'll be the father you've always wanted. One of his names is Everlasting Father, the Father that never leaves you, never forsakes you, won't abuse you, loves you unconditionally, just the way you are. And all you have to do is turn for him. That's all you have to do, is say, God, I want you. I want you in my life. I want to hear your voice. I want to feel what others have felt. I want that for me. It's that simple. He's not some far-off God. He's not way up in heaven, because we understand that in him we live and move and have our being. And when he gives you the eyes of understanding to have that real for you, well, then it changes everything. Then you find you don't need drugs. You don't need alcohol. You don't need things to cover up that pain. You have the confidence to face every day knowing that God is with you. And with him, you can do all things. Without him, you can't do anything. You know, if you go off on your own way, you know, you already know what that means. And you already know where that leads. Try him. See. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. He's not there to keep you from doing things. He's there to keep you from harm. And he wants to lead you into things that will truly satisfy. He wants to give you your heart's desire. No good thing will he withhold from those that love him. No good thing. That is an everlasting Father. If you want that, if you want a relationship with him, ask him for it. It's a very simple prayer. Jesus, if you're there, if you want me, here I am. Here I am. Show me. Come into my heart. Make me new. Ask him to forgive you. And just like Lisa, you can find the grace to forgive those who've harmed you. You can do it all when you just ask him. If you want help in that prayer, we've got a toll-free number for you. 888-777-1999. There's somebody on the other end of that phone. They're not there to judge you. They're not there to condemn you, tell you all about all the bad things you've done. No, they're there to tell you that God loves you, and he wants to be with you, and he wants you to be with him for all eternity. Call it now. Do it now. 888-777-1999. Well, we've gotten some questions in from our chat room. Let's go over to Joseph for the first one.
We have Kathy in the chat room. She says, what are the ways that we can pray for the celebrities to handle the pressure they are under?
There are a lot of different ways you can pray for people, but I think the one of the best prayers to pray for somebody under the pressure of celebrity is, God, make a way for them. And the Bible says very clearly that there is no temptation, that God does not make a way of escape. So pray, Lord, make the way of escape plain and obvious, and show them the way out of it, and lead them out of it. That would be a great prayer. And then also pray that his peace would be on them. I think that's one of the great prayers, the blessing that Aaron would pray over the children of Israel, is to, you know, lift up your countenance on them, be gracious unto them. Cause your face to shine upon them and give them peace. If you pray that way, they'll get it. Let's go over to Marguerite for the next one.
This is from Kay. She says, if you're in the entertainment industry, how do you make sure that you do not get caught up in addiction?
Here's an old proverb. If you hang out in the barbershop, you're going to get your hair cut. So don't hang out in the barbershop. Don't go to those parties. There are a lot of hangers-on in the entertainment world that come to these famous people with all kinds of offers that they can't refuse. What they're trying to get is access, and get access to the fame, and somehow think that they're better if they're hanging out with Whitney Houston, for example. And so if they can use chemicals and create some kind of dependence where their access is guaranteed, they'll do it. And that's one of the problems with fame, is you get a lot of hangers-on. So don't hang out in the barbershop. That's all the time we have for today's show. We leave you these words from 1 Chronicles. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Proclaim salvation day after day. God bless you.